Clap for yourself. That was great. I don't see any lady around, so it's only gentlemen. Welcome to the second edition of the Accra Academy Bleoo'97 Annual Mentorship and Career Development Talk. Last year, we had it here and it was great. And I know this time too, it's going to be very, very great. You are all welcome. To start or to get the ball rolling, we'll call upon Bleoobi Set Franklin Enchi, 97, head pastor of ICGC, Dome Branch, to pray with us.
Bleoo, let's please be on our feet for a word of prayer. We give you glory, Lord, as we honor you. Let's sing it together. We give you glory, Lord, as we honor you. Oh, you are wonderful. You are worthy, oh Lord. You are wonderful. You are worthy. Let's sing it for the last time. Lift up your voice. Let's sing it again. Go. We give you glory, Lord, as we honor you. Oh, we give you glory, Lord, as we honor you. You are wonderful. You are worthy, oh Lord. You are wonderful. You are wonderful. Can we all close our eyes for a word of prayer? Father, in the name of Jesus, we are grateful unto you for such a time like this in your presence. We thank you so much, O God, for counting us worthy to be here this morning. We ask that your presence will overshadow every activity on paper this morning. And we are also asking that, Lord, you will use our speakers to touch our lives. As we have gathered this morning, may you shape visions this morning. Influence us so we can also influence our societies. In the name of Jesus, I pray that, Lord, you open the floodgate of heaven and you will pour your blessings on us. We thank you. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Seth Franklin. I would please entreat you to still stand on your feet even as we want to sing the school anthem. I'll be inviting Sechi David to lead us sing the school anthem.
You have built nations of men. One, sing. You have built nations of men. You make great men of them. Generations of scholars salute you. Black and gray acknowledge you. A lifetime of feeding in thought, in words and deeds. Accepted with dairy. Accepted with dairy. Accepted with dairy. True to the spirit we live. Grabs the substance. Leave the shadows. Then onwards to the truth. Accepted with dairy. How great family. Esekwam widari. Esekwam widari. Esekwam widari. To the spirit we leave. Grabs the substance. Leave the shadows. Then onwards to the truth. Esekwam widari, our great family. Thank you.
Akraka! Please be seated. Please be seated. I don't know how long you've been in the school, but I could see that you were also doing the A and O that we used to do. Next on the program, we'll be having the welcome address by the president of Bleoo'97, Bleoobi Albert Quartey.
Akraka. 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 I like the spirit. I can see that you're already in the mood. So before I proceed with any welcome address, I'd like us to see one or two OJ to calm your nerves and charge you into the program. So be outstanding. If you know the song that I'm about to sing, you sing along with me. Achade, achade. Achade, achade. Oh la la la, e la la, la la. La la la, e la la. La la la, e la la. La la la, e la la, la la la. E la la la, e la. I give my life to a Akraka, the school which I like. I tell my mother that she will save me no more. If I die in Akraka, I die in Bleoo. Every academician is fighting for his right. Okay, we are resting. Akraka. The last of the two songs was rearranged and recomposed by my year group, Bleoo'97, 1997, 20 years back, of which I played a very instrumental role. So give it up to the Bleoo'97. I am highly delighted that my year group, Bleoo'97, is organizing this event for the second time running. Let me give you the genesis of this program. It was initiated by our seniors, Bleoo'84, a decade ago. Somewhere along the line, there was a gap, meaning they couldn't continue for 4 good years. So last year, my year group thought it wise, to revive what was beautifully started by our seniors. Let me give it to Bleoo'84. And with the blessing coming from the headmaster, we revived it last year, and here we are doing it for the second time. Inshallah, this program has come to stay. And my colleagues over here will bear with me. We are going to do it for the next 12 years, probably 2028. Can I hear you all? Nice one. As you being the fresh students of Accra Academy, better known as JJC, who understands JJC? JJC. Anyway, let me make it very short. Johnny just came. Meaning you just came into the Accra Academy. You're about to be taught through the words and things of Accra Academy, right? We have our own unique Bleoo way, whereby Bleoobi old boys who will try and come and welcome you whilst you are spending the 3 years in Accra Academy. And 2028, you are going to be called Bleoobi. For now, you are not Bleoobi. None of you qualify to be Bleoobi, right? You are only no Bleoobi. Bleoobi are those who have completed Accra Academy. Our advice that you take attention, prof further to all the issues that the speakers will be coming out with. Because you know why? You are very fortunate, blessed, and meritorious. Because there were so many candidates who chose Accra Academy as their first choice. But here are you only being Accra Academy. They couldn't get admission to Accra Academy. So you are very blessed and fortunate. Among those who couldn't even get a crack at them are my own relatives and four other relatives from my year group. But here we are, we're trying to organize the event. Because we believe you merit Accra Academy, right? Our distinguished welcome you all to this interactive, participatory, and educative program. Don't let be deluded that any question that we'll be asking is silly or irrelevant. Probe further, you can ask as many questions as you think, right? Probe, through the interaction, you get to know quite a lot of things. I wish you all, and thank you. Akraka.
No.
Akraka.
No.
Thank you, Mr. President. That was a very inspiring welcome address. The chairman for today's occasion doesn't need too much introduction. He is well known in the academic circles. He happens to be the headmaster of Accra Academy. Gentlemen, help me welcome Mr. Samuel Ofori AJ.
It's okay. Hey, you must know when to do what I told you. If I get you up there, I'll punish you. I've told you we have a time for everything. Do you hear me? Today is a working day. But you've seen this Bleoobi sacrificing their time because of you. As I speak with you, there are several headmasters in my office waiting for us to attend a meeting. And because this program is important to us, that's why I want to make a presence and then put you in the shape for the program. You are a bit noisy. What they've assembled for us, all the topics are very important. And don't let their efforts be in vain. The president mentioned it. About 2 years ago, they approached us in management to do this program for you. If you look at the program lineup, they brought people who are very busy in their fields to come and speak with you and to give you a direction. So this is not the time for you to misbehave. When the president led you through some Jama songs, as soon as the songs are over, we end it there. And even I was expecting that while you came to this program, you would hold some notebook to be jotting down some of the things that they will say. Because what we've realized is that most of you behave like they are pouring water on stone and it's not permeating. We want whatever they are going to say to fall on good soil so that some of you or all of you will aspire to be like they are or even do better. Role modeling is something which is helping in the educational system. when we continue to sit you in the classroom, the four walls of a classroom, take our markers and say 2 + 2 = 4, or we tell you the history of the Yas and Tuwa war, or we tell you something about titration, that is not the end of life. There is more to it than what you learn in the classroom. They can attest to you that most of the things they are doing now, they necessarily did not learn them in the classroom. So it is important that you share these experiences. When they are sharing them with you, you listen. You listen carefully so that you don't fall into any problem. I think this is not the first time I'm saying it. You are about 687, and that is only one school in Ghana. There are some schools who have enrollment figures over and above ours. Some have admitted over 1,000 students. So the question is, how am I going to compete with several thousands of students in my category, whether you are a visual arts student, you are a general arts student, you are a business student, you are an Greek student, or you are a science student? Thousands of your compatriots are elsewhere. But how many of them are gaining from the experience which your seniors are going to share with you today? That is why I'm saying that. And I told you when I met you for the first time, I told you, let's clearly differentiate between what is serious and what is a joke. When we are on the field playing football, we are playing table tennis, that is the time where we should be applauding and be shouting. But once we are in the classroom or we come to a formal program like this, I don't expect any noise making. I don't expect those who will sit behind and be pulling other people's shorts. Pay attention and make maximum use of today. Don't forget, what they are doing is equally important, or else you should be having some classes. You are losing some subject periods today. But this is equally important. That's why we are giving the whole of this day for them to take you through this. And I don't want any of you to be moving around aimlessly, because whatever they've brought, very important. I've seen the program and I know how rich it is. And I hope that when the question and answer period comes, I would have finished with what I'm doing and I'll come back and join you. And I would want you to pay attention and ask probing questions. In Akan, there is a funny proverb that Akwala Unia Obeto Kano Onoma No Bisa Bicycle Taibo. The child who will grow and buy a vehicle one day, he will be asking of the price of the tire of a bicycle. What we mean is that smaller things generate into greater things. So it is the way you start. That is why I don't take certain jokes when you come in Form 1. It is the foundation that you lay that will make you grow into responsible adults. You understand what I'm saying? So I will want to take a little time off, meet with the National Child Executives. They are doing some program today and they are in my office right now. When I finish with them in probably another 1 hour, I'll come back and be part of the program and see how you are comporting yourselves. Let your seniors who left here close to 20 years ago, let them see you as credible students who have taken over from them, and that whatever you do will move the school notches higher instead of us degenerating into lawlessness and things which do not help the development of a school. You have come at a time when we made the best results in the history of Accra Academy so far. So it is a challenge to you. The several 8 A's, as for the 7 A's, they are uncountable, and the 6 A's. It is a challenge. The bar has been raised, and it is for you to reach that bar at least, or go above it. And some of these things that we are doing this morning, one of these is supposed to ginger you on. I'm sure they are going to pull you along, make school life very interesting, their own experiences in and out of school, so that you will also follow their track. Before I sit down, you see that their year group, there may be hundreds of them, but how many have actually come? I know some are busy elsewhere, but there are those who did not listen to their colleagues' advice, pieces of advice, and they cannot be found anywhere. They are not dead, but they cannot be found. I don't think you want to belong to that group. You want to belong to those who have come. They are going to introduce themselves to you, where they are working, how they got there, to encourage you to also move up. This is what I'm expecting from you. And I expect that you will sit quietly and listen attentively. When you are moving, then it's possibly you want to visit the loo and then come back. I don't want to hear any unnecessary noise. I'll be in the office there. When I hear the noise, I'll come. And then we'll identify those who are making the noise. I would want you to benefit maximally from today's program. It is supposed to be a mentorship and career development talk. So after they've spoken, if your area of interest is not touched on during question time, you can raise up your hand, and I'm sure they've brought enough resource persons to give you direction in those areas as well. If they can't, they will let you know. But I believe that they have what it takes to be able to tell you how to go about what you want to be in future, because it is supposed to be a mentorship and career development. School is to prepare you for you to enter the world of work. So it is important that you know where you are going to, so that you can follow the path to that end. I want the class prefects, I met you the other time and I gave you some assignments. Your assignment does not end only in the classroom. In a forum like this, you also have that same assignment. So class prefects and their assistants, let's see how today, Wednesday, we are going to benefit from our own 20 years or so, or 21 years, 22 years ago, they were like you. But today, they are somewhere else and they want to share their experiences with you. I wish you all the best. At the end of the program, probably one day, I'll just come to your classroom and ask you to tell me what you remember about what transpired in the KG Konuah Hall today. So listen with rapt attention and put down as many notes as possible, so that when I come to your class and ask you, you will be in the position to tell me what you benefited from for today. As I said, I may be on and off because of other assignments. In this note, I want to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to be part of them, more importantly, to be the chairman. But my duties are many, so I'm here with you in body. Even if I'm away, I'm here with you in spirit. And I hope you will give your junior brothers the best, so that they will forever remember this day as one of the momentous occasions in their lives when they came to Accra Academy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Headmaster. Thank you. Oh, you can give him a very big round of applause. Thank you, Mr. Headmaster. That was very insightful, thought-provoking, a very powerful and encouraging speech. We'll still be upstanding even as he would ask to attend to other equally important duties. May we be seated, please. 1995, we also entered Accra Academy. That is about 21 years ago. I was very short, slim, tiny, like an atom. But now, by the grace of God, I am somehow small, obolo, and tall. Our first speaker for today, studied business in Accra Academy. He holds a Bachelor of Science degree in Business Administration, Accounting Option from University of Ghana Business School, Legon. He also holds a Master's degree in Business Administration in Strategic Management from Blekingen Institute of Technology, Sweden. He has a rich working background in banking, finance, energy and agriculture, and has worked with UMB, Altimas Resources, and ECM. He is currently the chairman of BBEmpire Limited and managing director of Greenshields Resources. He is married and with a futuristic plan to produce enough food to feed Africa. Gentlemen with our ladies, help me welcome Bleoobi Sylvester Vuvor.
Akyerekwah. Akyerekwah. Please sit down. Now, before I start, I was once like you, and I was wondering when I'll get the opportunity to talk to people like I'm doing now. One thing I've observed is that most of us are timid, and it's even affecting some of us. You know, we can't talk in public, and we may have something beneficial to others, but we can't expose ourselves. We can't, you know, relate to others. But before I start, I mean, I just wanted to talk about Agri. I have other experiences. I've worked in a bank. I did business, as some of you have done. I went to Legon, did accounting, but that's not all. So before I start, I want to do some, you know, they asked me my speech. I've not prepared anything. I just want us to have some chat. So we are starting with the guys out here. Please come. The seven guys. Come up. Come. Now, you mention your names. You mention your name. I'll ask you a question. So you mention your name. And which class are you? What course are you?
My name is Raymond Saba. I'm in 1 General Arts 2. I'm doing General Arts.
I'm Bernard Adu. 1 General Arts 1.
You say the name is what?
Bernard Adu.
Okay.
I'm Abochi Makafi, 1 Science 3.
I am Sylvester Mensah, 1 Bass 4.
I am Callum Jonathan, 1 Science 1.
I am Charles Opon Jr., 1 General 1.
Okay, starting from you, what do you want to be in future?
I want to be an air controller.
What?
Air controller.
Air controller, okay. The next person?
I want to be a cardio surgeon.
A cardio surgeon, okay.
A financial analyst.
Financial analyst.
A neurosurgeon.
A neurosurgeon.
A computer engineer.
A computer engineer.
A lawyer.
A what? A lawyer. Okay. You see how beautiful it is. Great academician. Okay, that's nice. Please stand. Now, I want to find out among you who wants to be a teacher. Okay, we have about how many hands? 3. Okay. Out of 680, only 3 wants to be teachers. Okay. Who wants to be carpenter? Carpenter. Okay. And who wants to be a farmer? Hello. Now you see, all of you wants to be neurosurgeons, lawyers, financial analysts, doctors, air controllers. None of you wants to be a carpenter. None of you wants to be a farmer. But who in this hall doesn't eat rice? Who doesn't eat salt? Who doesn't eat sugar? All of you eat rice. All of you eat sugar. All of you eat salt. But none of you want to produce what you eat. That is the case we have in Ghana, where much of the students or the educated folks are only interested in white collar jobs. We all want to be in offices, drive big cars, always wants to be in air conditions, but none of us wants to till the land. None of us wants to produce something for others to eat. Now, I want to continue again with these guys. Please, I'm not putting you on the stand. All what you want to be, we need them. Without a doctor, without a neurosurgeon, we'll all die. Without a lawyer, we'll all die. Without financial analyst, there will no be bank. I was once a financial analyst, but today I'm a farmer. All I want to share with you today is that maybe education is not just about what you study. You are studying science today. But what you are studying should be towards a broader, expectation. Not just, I'm doing science, therefore I want to be a doctor. You can be a doctor, but look at things from other perspective. You are about 800, and I'm sure SS2, they will be around 600, and SS1, maybe 500. In all, you are about 2,000. And every morning you eat, every afternoon you eat. Evening you eat, but you don't think of where the food is coming from. Who should produce for you? Our mothers and fathers in the villages who don't know A or B, they are producing to feed you. Now let me give you an example. Currently there's been some tomatoes in the market. The tomatoes were so big, people were wondering, where from these tomatoes? Do you know what happened? The government gave out some cheap fertilizers for cocoa, and cocoa takes 3-4 years to grow. So when they use these fertilizers, they expect that the chemicals in them within 4 years will minimize. But the local farmer who doesn't know anything took this hot fertilizer to apply to tomato that grows within 3 months, and they became so big. And I know the kitchen woman will buy. And you will eat, you will be sick. You all, is there, what's the name? Clinic still there, at the back here. So you've given your life to the poor farmer, the illiterate man there, because you want to be a neurosurgeon. You don't want to be a farmer, you don't want to be a carpenter. But if you die, it's a coffin that will bury you. You forgot it. All I'm here to share is that, look, go out there, study whatever you want to study. Make sure you get to the university. But you are not in the university just for the sake of why you were there. Maybe you've gone to study science, you've gone to study medicine. Study the medicine. Read widely. Have a broad-minded... Yeah, I'll let him sit down. Please go and sit down. Please go and sit down. If I need you, I'll call you. The main reason why I kept them standing was that I wanted to find out from you whether someone will be able to tell me what is common about them. Who can tell me what was common about the six people that came here? What is common? Anyone? Tell me. They are what? They are all boys. That's one, correct? Clap for him. Okay. Yeah. Yes, they are all wearing white top, isn't it? That's right. What again? Yeah. They all wanted what? White collar job. That's good. What again? They are all students of Accra Academy. Is that not it? Now, all I want to ask you is that nobody was able to tell me, oh, one is hot, is coming from the Volta region, one is coming from the Ashanti region. Here, we are all together. We are all brothers. They are all academicians. And what you need to do is to be one. There shouldn't be any division among yourselves. Put yourself together. Len, I remember when we were here, you know, our class was just here. My class was here. And what we do is that Accra Academy, we don't have the best teachers. The best teachers are the students here. There are brilliant students among you. Who knows? You don't feel proud of what you know. What you need to do is to rather teach your colleagues. I remember we have good guys in our class, and we don't challenge ourselves, but we rather challenge the teachers. When a teacher comes, we want to see where the teacher is not good at, and we point holes to that side. I remember we sacked one teacher, and the teacher went to tell the other class that this class is not good at all. They are poor people. They are, you know, their minds are all dead, you know. Just because when it comes to the class, the questions that are asked, sometimes he just walks out and said, oh, I'm coming back. I'll go and verify and come back. That is what you need to do. It's not about winning brilliant science. It's not about winning, being the best student in the whole Ghana. If we have 10 of you getting out to impact life in society, is better than we having one person from Accra Academy saying he's the best student in the whole world. Do you understand what I'm saying? So today, let me use the last minutes to talk about agric, why I'm a farmer. Now, when I got to Accra Academy, I studied accounting. First, when I was a child, I said I want to be a pilot. Later, I changed to a doctor. Then I said, no, I like money, money, money. So business, you know. So I came to Accra Academy, studied, accounting, business. When we got to the university, I said, Charlie, since I studied business, I need to do business. So I did administration. After administration, I worked in the bank for 10 years. Now, whilst in the bank, I was being paid well. You know, if I say I'm not being paid, I'm lying. But I realized at the end of each month, all the money that I'm paid is finished. I don't know what I'm doing with it. I'm not building. I don't have anything, but the money gets finished. So I was thinking of, no, I'm not happy to working as a banker, because every morning I have to get up early as 5 o'clock. By 6:30, you are driving in traffic. You need to get to the office before your boss comes, and you need to impress every time. This is what I have done for 10 years. I got fed up. Then I look back. Then I saw my poor, illiterate mother, who is a maize seller. You know, whenever she needs money, in Ghana, when you see a banker, it means he's a rich man, isn't it? That's the perception. So my mother also have that perception. Anytime she's coming to me, it's as if she's been lectured what to say in order to get the money from me. So she'll tell me, look, she'll do all the analysis of the maize she's going to buy, and the profit that will be on it, you know. And to me, I look at this illiterate poor woman. She wants to deceive me. But after second thought, I realized, no, this woman has some idea. but because she's illiterate, she's not putting it right. Do you understand? Let me use the school that I've attended to turn it around. Do you understand? To turn it around and see how best, you know, I can impact life in society. So when it was getting to the 10th year, I decided, no, I'll get into Agri. Now, how do I tell people I want to be a farmer? If you tell someone you want to be a farmer, you are working. Even my wife, when I said I was resigning, it was a problem. So what I need to tell her is that I was transferred to Takwa, and I don't want to be in Takwa. And up to now, if we meet someone, my wife is a doctor, is a medical doctor. If you meet somewhere and I tell someone I'm a farmer, trouble. So I need to say I'm an agriculture consultant. Because none of you wants to be a farmer. Because if I were to come here, if they didn't mention he attended Accra Academy, Legon, he has masters in this, he's chairman of this. They just came here and said, oh, an old student is a farmer. Clap for him. I'm sure none of you would have even clapped in the first place. But you just admitted that all of you eat rice. So I moved it into what? Into agriculture. And I realized there is so much we need to do. But before we get to feeding ourselves, we need people that are educated. We need to tell people like you, what is the benefit in agriculture? You don't need to study agriculture in SSS to be a farmer. You can be a doctor and still be a farmer. You can be a neurosurgeon and still be what? A farmer. But the issue is, the rice you eat today, do you know where it comes from? It comes from the US, comes from China, Thailand, Vietnam. And you are, do you know Vietnam? Eh? Do you know what it means when you eat rice from Vietnam? Meaning you are buying that rice in dollars. Do you know that? Why can't we produce to feed ourselves? Now let me give you a scenario. I know all of you are mathematically inclined. I had a customer that imported maize into this country. Maize, common maize, is imported, is brought from what? Russia into this country. Now the maize, he had about 440,000 bags, you know, that big bag. So he asked me to sell those bags. So now I'm doing my mother's business. I sell maize, isn't it? Now let me tell you, you work, you move out of this place and be a neurosurgeon and work for 10 years, you won't get the money I got from that maize if I had to sell it. I'm telling you. Let's do the analysis. Now the 440,000 bags, he asked me, I asked him how much will I get, a commission on each. He said one CD. Now if I sell 440,000 bags, how much do I get? One person, how much do I get? Ghana cedis. Do you know how much is that? Do you know what it can do? Now, the first question I want you to ask any of the speakers, whether they've ever seen that 440,000 in their account. Any of the speakers, I'm the farmer talking to you. Do you understand? So you see what I can get as a farmer. So don't sit out there and think farmers are poor, you know. I've had a discussion with the headmaster, and I told him, please stop punishing students by asking them to weed, because when you weed as a punishment, you consider it as what? Farming as punishment, and the kind of farming you do is not using cutlasses and hoes. There are machines that help. So please, what I'm just asking is, just broaden your mind. Read wide. You are in the science class, you are in the business class, you are in the art class. It doesn't mean that's where you end. Just broaden your mind. A lot of you might not even go to the university. But that doesn't mean after SSS, that is all for you. If that is all for you, please look for me. My name is Sylvester Vuvor. We'll farm together. And we'll feed Ghanaians. Right? So all I ask is, whenever they say a carpenter, a farmer, a mason, don't look down upon them. Don't look down upon those professions. I have another experience to share. I used to do carpentry. That's why I mentioned carpenter. Now, I was working in the bank, and I had a passion for this carpentry. It came as a result of some landlord's foolishness, you know. We rented a place, he's always pushing us about, you know, so we decided to build something. So I said, okay, then I'll do the carpentry part. I'm not a carpenter, but there are carpenters out there. All I need is to employ some of them to work for me, isn't it? But that makes me a carpenter, isn't it? But I'm what? Educated carpenter, right? Now, out of carpentry, the first job I had it through a friend who is an architect. We went to, an ambassador. So I said, Charlie, give me this job. You know, I want to do it to my best perfection. When we got to the ambassador, my friend foolishly introduced me to the bank, to the ambassador as a banker. Then I approached the man that I wanted to be the one to do your carpentry stuff. He got annoyed. You are a banker, you want to do my carpentry thing. What kind of nonsense is that? You think I'm joking here? You know, the man was so annoyed, he didn't want to talk to me. It was a Saturday, so I left. The next day, we came back again. So I approached him with a proposal. And I told him, Ambassador, I realized you were annoyed yesterday. Yes, I'm a banker, but I do carpentry as a hobby. And I think I could do what you want me to do. But this is the proposal. I'll finance. I'll use my money to do whatever you want to do. If it is good for you, you pay. If it's not good, I'll pay for the distraction of what I'm doing. But if it is well done, Ambassador, you pay dearly. The ambassador said, yeah, I like that kind of challenge. Okay, let's do that. I said, okay, what do you want? He mentioned the things he wants. I drove to Enyinem, going to Kumasi, bought the wood, dried them, and brought them back. Now, I called the carpenters. I told them, this is the challenge. Now, this is the cost, and this is the profit. Now, all the profit belongs to you. It's not mine. This is my first job. I don't care to lose. And the guys were serious, working day and night. We got to a point when the ambassador came. When he came down, I asked the guys to leave. He got to the place. I didn't hear from him. The third day, he was at the airport and called me, Sylvester, I love your job. I said, Ambassador, you are dead. Ambassador paid the money. After paying the money, I charged him $20,000. And that's what I took. That bought my first pickup. If everybody knows I drive a pickup, that bought the first pickup I have. He said, oh, but that's too much, Ambassador. It was an agreement. You said I was a banker, I cannot do carpentry. And I showed you I can. And I went to borrow the money. And what you need to pay is $20,000. And that's what I had. And the second car I bought, though I was a banker, was through carpentry. That's 6 years ago. That's some Mercedes-Benz you see back there. The blue black. It's true carpentry. It's not true financing. So please, stop underrating some jobs. The job, you be a neurosurgeon. Yes, it's good. We need them. If you have brain issues, you need him to solve your problem. We need a doctor. If I'm a farmer and maybe a cattle cuts me, I need a doctor. Do you understand? But that is not all. The most important thing is, what can you do to impact other lives? People are dying as a result of poverty. There are a lot of people on the street that are mad. Seriously, they are not mad. about 80% of them are nomad. Provide them with three lunch a day, three meals. They'll be okay. They'll talk to you nicely. It's just poverty. It's nothing. And it's just because we've what, left other jobs that are very important to our livelihood untouched. So please, I'm not saying don't study the arts you are doing, the business. Don't. Today, if I need a signed contract, and if I need a contract, I need a lawyer, isn't it? A lawyer has to draft the contract. But all of you cannot be lawyers. All of you cannot be neurosurgeons. Among you, only a few may succeed to be doctors. But if you've not crossed your path, there's something you can rely on, and that is agriculture. Thank you. Accra, Accra.
You should show appreciation by standing and clapping and doing it. Brother. Yeah, you can sit there. Bleoobi, Sylvester, Vuvor, that was very thought-provoking. So I'm sure now if you ask people who want to be farmers, you will get a lot of people now. How many of you want to be farmers? You see, Sylvester. Clap for yourself, that's great. Our second speaker studies science in Accra Academy and holds a Bachelor of Science degree in Business Administration Marketing Option from the University of Ghana Islamic College. He further pursued a master's degree in international finance from Shanghai University of Finance and Economics, China. He was a special aide to the former Vice President of the Republic of Ghana, His Excellency Alhaji Aliyu Muhammad of blessed memory. He also worked in China as a teacher and administrator. He is currently the Business Development Director at China Africa Development Fund and married with children. Help me welcome Bleoobi Mahama Nashiru.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Good morning, fellow Bleoobis, and good morning, my distinguished colleagues. Before I move to say whatever I have to say this morning, I will want to acknowledge one distinguished personality or one illustrious son of Ghana, who I cannot tell the story of my life without mentioning him integrally, without mentioning him highly. And this man has placed, he has been a father I never had. He has been my mentor. He has been my inspirator, he has been my everything entirely, and he is the very reason why I attended Accra Academy, and he subsequently took me further than Accra Academy. And today, as 16th November 2016, exactly today, 4 years ago, on the 16th of November 2012, he was called to his maker. So you will realize that today is exactly 4 years when he passed. Ghana woke up that morning on the 16th of November to hear the sad news that its longest serving vice president had passed. He was a loyal servant, and he has done an impeccable service generally to humanity, especially me. As for me, if you turn left to talk about me, you cannot say without him. If you turn right to talk about me, you cannot do it without mentioning him highly. And so it's not, or is this a sweet coincidence that today I am here to tell the story of my life and how God has, or where God has brought me to. And today happens to be the day he died, anniversary. So I want to crave your indulgence, you distinguished, beautiful audience, with the permission of the MC and you all here, to please be upstanding. Let's observe a minute silence in honor of this illustrious son of Ghana, my own father, my own uncle, my own inspirator, my own inspirer, my own mentor. It was the saddest day in my life when I got the news that he had passed. I didn't know where I was. Thank God today, Accra Academy, Bleoobi'97 called me here to come and say something about me. And I cannot do it without mentioning him. So thank you for standing. And at this point, we observe a minute silence in honor of this great man of Ghana. Thank you very much, and may the souls of the departed rest in perfect peace. Thank you. Please be seated. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. What you have just done means a lot to me. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. My humble life began all the way a village in Yendi, Northern Region. I was a very grown boy, looking like not going to go to school. It looked like I wasn't going to be educated. My people just confided me to attend an Arabic school, and it was just what we were known to be doing. One hot afternoon, a gentleman came to our house. I was seated with my dad, and then he was holding something in his hand. Apparently, it was a school uniform that was made for me by my late uncle. And the instruction or the plea to my dad was that he wants this gentleman to be sent to school. That was how I began my educational life. It was the turning moment. I started school all the way in Yendi. I did it. My dad supervised, would check my homework, do everything necessary a dad would do to the son. I was so much into it. I was doing it with all the enthusiasm you can think of. And I was a very bright student. Unfortunately, another unfaithful afternoon, a news broke up that my dad, who had gone on a trade mission, had a very fatal accident, and unfortunately, he passed. Once again, it was a very bad moment for me. I endured it, and some days later, my uncle once again came to me and said, "Hey, we are moving you to Tamale to continue your education. I'm just trying to tell you how I got to Accra Academy and what was said to me and what happened. So please listen carefully." I started schooling in Tamale, now without my parents, living with my foster, now my uncle and his wife. So it was an entirely new life for me. Not very easy, not easy at all. But I endured, I did all I could. Finally, I got myself to the JSS. I started at Kalponhene SDA, where class 3, and it was nicely, everything. Was the biggest boy in the class, and the brightest. And the class prefect, from class 3, class 4, class 5, to class 6, class prophet. Class 6, he was the SP. GSS 1, he was a class prophet. GSS 2, class prophet. GSS 3, the school prophet one more time. And then I led my badge. We came out with distinction with aggregate 6. 9 ones. Only 2 twos was found in my resource. I'm sure many of you have gotten the same results and you are here today. I was the happiest man on earth. Coming from an uncompleted school, it was so nice. My uncle saw my resource and said, this is a beautiful resource. I cannot allow you to continue your schooling in Tamale. I will send you all the way to Accra Academy. It was the most exciting news for me. I'm sure when you got the admission that you were coming to Accra, it was like, yeah, I'm going to the best school on earth. Yes, indeed, Accra is the best. You have every right to be happy. But when I was about to leave home for school, after getting all my provisions and my beautiful, nice trunk and chop box ready to fly to Accra Airport, then my uncle sat me down and then he told me, hey, young man, you are going to begin a new life. You are going to be live a life on your own now. You are going to a secondary school. But remember, this school is a very good school. Remember that a school does not make a student does not, what did I say? A school does not make a student. It's a student that makes a school. It does not matter where you are. What matters most is how you are. Listen carefully, my brothers and sisters. I was seated here 20 years ago, not knowing where to go. He told me, a school does not make a student. It's you, this beautiful student here, that makes a school. It does not matter where you are. What matters most is how you are. So do not come to Accra and blow your shoulders up to your colleagues out there, even at home, and to the girls out there and say, I'm a student of Accra and that's enough. No way. Accra will never cut open your head and put in all the miracles that you need to have from education. No. It's you. It's from you, yourself. It's from you as an individual. You need to work hard. You need to sit up. What your teachers will give you in the class probably might not be enough. You need to do extra work yourself. That's the only way you can become the best. You know what happened? When I got here, I was so excited, I forgot all that my uncle told me. I started jumping around, doing all things on my own. I didn't care what. I even became a prophet. I mean, I was the preps prophet. I'm sure my chairman would, I was one of his ministers. He was our SP back then. And the chaplain is here, and several others. Yeah. Yes. We used to make it like a head of preps prophets department. And Ami Awado, who was the entertainment prophet, we say he's the head of entertainment prophets department. Yes, I was. And I was a leader to several small unions in the school. I forgot entirely what my uncle told me, that I should sit up, that I should study hard, that I should take my own destiny into my own hands and do it by myself. I forgot all. I didn't do it. You know what happened to me at the end of the day? I failed. Yes. A lot of my colleagues do not know that I left Accra Academy with failed results. Yes. I failed out of campus. You know why? Because I didn't listen to advice. Because I didn't take up the challenge that it's time to study. So be mindful. You sit here. If you don't study hard, I promise you, in 3 years' time, or how many years you are doing now, you will leave here with failed results. You will disappoint yourself, your family, and everybody around you, and you cannot go nowhere. You stay there. My experiences as a failure can never, the story should be left untold. It's best experienced than be told, honestly. You don't want to go through that. So my brothers, take up this golden opportunity. Accra will give you everything you need. Every tuition will be given to you. But the onus lies on you yourself to really make it happen. If you don't make it happen, you will come out a failure. You come out a dropout. But when I went home and life began showing negative sides to me, I saw things differently. People were now like, this guy wasn't not this bright boy from GSS who made distinction with many ones. Was it just a lie? Was he really brilliant? I didn't fail because I wasn't brilliant, because I did not study. Remember, I did not fail because I wasn't brilliant. You all are very brilliant students. So what you need to do is to study hard. If you don't study hard, you will fail. And if you fail, life will be negative on your side. So wake up. If you have been sleeping and watching your friends going out with their books to study at night, you need to do same. Even if you are a day student, you can do same at home. So when things started becoming really bad on my side, I realized that no, it's not good for me. I need to pick up myself, I dusted myself, I sat up. But you know what? It's very difficult to pass your exams at home than to pass in the school. Because in the school, you have the whole time to yourself. In the house, what happened? You've been having some house errands to take care of, and you don't have the whole time to yourself to study. So you can't make it very well at home. It took me a long time to better my grades. Even at a point, I almost gave up, and I came to my uncle. That time, he became the vice president of Ghana, and then I came with an invitation from a friend in the United States, and then I said, hey, uncle, please, I want to travel to the United States. He saw that I was giving up in education. You know what he told me? He said, my brother, not too fast. I can make you travel tomorrow, but go back home, better your grades, and go to school. If you are in the school, if you go to university, you will travel like no other business. And that's what I did. I went back home. That's why I'm saying this man has inspired me. He has been a life changer. He has touched my life. So I went back, I did it, and then I was in the university. I came to Boga. Then he told me, not very fast, I want you to go back to the village. I have a project there. You need to supervise it. It was long vac. You supervise it for 3 months before I can attend to you on traveling issues. And then I was like, what is this man doing to me? I didn't know he was giving me a very proper training. Now I'm appreciating what he did for me. I'm sure he's looking down on me with great pride. What I've become today. A mover, a shaker, an employer. I've also now become an inspirer or something different among my colleagues. Let's get back to what I'm telling you. And then the following vacation, to his promise, he called me and just said, give your passport to the protocol officer. And it was done. A UK visa was stamped. And in UK, here I come. I buggered, I was in the UK, flying around, everything was fun. But you know one thing, I never wanted to always boast out there that I'm coming from this family. I didn't choose it. It's by great divine intervention of God that everybody is coming from his or her family. I didn't choose to belong to that family. I came there, but I wanted to always be humble. I always wanted to be very down to earth and do things on my own, not to be boasting with my family's background and whatever political power they have. I was in the UK, I did every work, from cleaning, from whatever. I even went as far as doing car wash, was washing cars. So, I mean, the lesson I want you to draw from this one is, please be modest. Please be down to earth. Be respectful. That is the only way you can go far. Even with all your educational, credentials, all the special values will even propel you further. And then one day I was in the, doing my usual car wash at Brent Cross in London, and then was doing so fast, giddy. Then I just jumped down from one of the cars I had washed, which was fetching me so much money. And then here was a very beautiful lady I was showing interest some time ago, and this lady has found me washing cars. Can you believe that? Wow, my head was on the ground. Say, hey, she used to call me honorable because of my family political, inclination. So it's honorable. What are you doing here? Wow, I was so ashamed. But I wasn't deeply in my heart ashamed because I was working hard because I wanted to earn some. I had a target. I wanted to make some money, come home and do something. What am I saying here? Always make a target. Always make a target that I want to achieve this. Do it positively. Be focused. I said to myself that this trip I'm embarking on, I want to come home and possess my own car and drive it on campus whilst I was in the university. And that was what I did. So challenge yourself that you will do this. And if you are determined, you will see it come to pass. Yeah, that aside. And then university was done. Working at the presidency, blah, blah, and all that. And then here was a decision. I'm now going to talk about China. A decision I had after my several travels to the UK. I had established contacts and I now had so many friends in the UK. I wanted to do my master's there. Then I searched for schools. I'd gotten admission. Everything was set. Scholarship package, everything nice. Then I came to my uncle. We are ready to go. You know what he told me? He said, hey, man, you are not going to the UK. I have something different for you. You are going to China to do your master's. I said, what? China? I was like, how? How can I leave UK and go to China? That's not right. But this man was determined. He said, no, China is the way. China is what is going to be tomorrow. China will hold the world tomorrow. China will be everywhere in the world tomorrow. Go to China. Study and study the language. I tried to persuade this man to change his mind. He wouldn't do it. So I said, okay, so be it. I went to China and I started. China was so good. China was a blessing. China has been a blessing and is continuing to be a blessing in my life. To be honest, I did my master's in international finance. The course was taught in English, but I went out of my way. Fine, the language was like prerequisite kind of thing. We did for 2 semesters, but I went out of my way and then I did Chinese language. My colleagues were like, ah, what's this guy doing? Is he crazy? And by the time we could talk about graduating from the school, I was able to get along speaking Chinese like never before. And I met this Chinese, beautiful Chinese girl. I said, hey, ni hao, ni zemayaya. Then she was like amazed. Hey, ni hui shua junwe ma. Then I said, do ya, we hui ya, what's about hui shua junwe ya? I was beginning to bluff with their own language. I was like, do ya, where's Mabuweya? You know what I was telling her? I was like, oh yes, I know how to speak Chinese language. What do you want to say? Go ahead, let's go and chat. Let's go ahead and chat. What do you want to say? Go ahead, come on, talk to me. And then she was so amazed. It's like a black man in our land speaking our own language. Who? Then she became a very good friend. You know, the Chinese language has brought me so much grace, so much blessing. And I think that I never had the opportunity of somebody advising me at this age that these are some of the things you'll meet on your way. When they come, please don't say no. Study the language. It will help you. Chinese language has become, those who can speak the language now are now like hot cake in the job market. I can tell you for a fact. Because I'm employing people who have Chinese background
everywhere. When I came back from China, before I came, a Chinese man who had come to our school to meet my classmates, African students who were on scholarship, were studying in China, and I happened to be the president of the African students in China. And then I rose up and made a speech. I was praising the man here and there. And then he didn't know I was just making a political, you know, just, it's normal for a leader to praise a guest when he comes. I did it, but the man was so amazed. He was like, I like this guy. But I did it, and I did it well in Chinese. Then he was like, hey, you came to our country, you've learned a language, you are even giving me proverbs. And then he was like, I want you to work for me. And I said, oh, really? Okay, let's do this. Then he said, okay, come with me to go to Ghana. But I didn't want to come to Ghana around that time. I said, oh, let me chill small in China, my brother. He followed me for 2 years. The man never gave up on me because I could speak the language. And then he wanted somebody like me. He followed me 2 years and finally got me to come and work with China Africa Development Fund. But before that, I met a very high, powerful panel in Beijing at the head office who interviewed me in Chinese for almost an hour. In Chinese, they were like, oh, ni dao jana ni wei bangju women nigga gun si shama yangzi ya ni gun women shuisha. Wow. And then I as usual, I had rehearsed some of their words, and then I know how to bluff with their language, and then I started. And so, chiga me went here, chiga washi jana dangdiren, wo dao jana chiga me went, wo shushu shi jana fu zon tong, wo kei bangu. And then, you know what I was telling him? He was asking me, how are you going to help us in Ghana when you come to work for our company? And then I said, this is not a problem. This is very easy. I'm a typical Ghanaian. I lived in Ghana all my life. I just came to China to study. And more so, that was the time my uncle was still the vice president. And I said, oh, my uncle is a former vice president. And then I don't see it to be a problem. If something is beyond me, I'll just rush to him. He brought me here, and he would gladly help me. And they were like, wow, that's amazing. You know, so I came to Ghana, and I started working. Now I am one of the most famous Chinese speaking guys in a very reputable company in Accra, China Africa Development Fund. We are the owners of African World Airline. We are also the owners of Asogli Power Plant. We have 84 projects in 30 different countries in Africa. Because of this opportunity, I have been able to travel to almost every West African country that you can think of. Every West Africa, because our office is in charge of West Africa. Now they have even added Central Africa for us. So I'm preparing my passport to even travel more. You know what it comes with? Per diem, fat ones. Yeah, this is just to encourage you that Chinese language is not something to just say, I won't do it. Even if you are here and there is French language in your curriculum, please don't ignore it. Right now, I'm taking up some French classes because those countries under our office's jurisdiction are French-speaking countries, largely. And so I need to be able to speak French. And when I grab the language, you know what it means? It comes with extra pay. You know, I'm just telling you all this to tell you the importance of language. Chinese, I was working with a lady when I came to Ghana in 2012. And then this lady, she went to China after her secondary education. And all she did was she just did her major in Chinese language. Now, she came back and CATFAN, China Africa Development Fund, employed her. And what was she earning? A lot of money. Not long after, Ecobank came and picked her away and now doubled her pay times two. When she left, I told my boss that, hey,
this lady has left too. She's gone, and she left because they have given her extra cash. What does that mean? It means that he has to look at me, and so he multiplied my times 2, and if he added plus 7. You know, so my brothers and sisters, language is doing really, really good, especially Chinese language. I have given employment to several people who have studied in China or who can speak the Chinese language, and they are in Ghana. All of them, if you just want to try me and believe what I'm telling you, just if you know somebody who can speak the Chinese language very fluently, just tell the person to see me today, and I promise you tomorrow he'll be working in a very juicy or at a very juicy place. Yes, that's what I'm saying. I'm telling you, it's not a joke. And look, with all these opportunities, I sit in my office and I have scholarship offers for brilliant students. I give it to my family and my friends and people who just come around and they are lucky, they meet the requirements. I give it to them. I have sent several people to China for no fee charge because I didn't get my pay, my own at a fee. Free. So the language is not just helping me and my family, enabling me do well in life, but it's also a life changer for other people. So my brothers, please don't ignore Chinese language when it ever comes your way. If you want to study Chinese language, even at your early age, University of Ghana is pursuing it now. It's not for nothing that University of Ghana has come out with all the things that is needed to study the language. Alliance Francaise is also doing Chinese language. So ladies, we don't have a lady here. I wanted to say distinguished ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for the opportunity given me to speak on this topic. I hope I have the chance again to talk again.
Wow. Ni hao. Did I get it right? Is it ni hao? Ni hao. You can give it to better one more time for Bleoobi. Please be seated. That was great. That was great. He said, a school doesn't make a student. It is a student that makes the school. And you have to take your destiny into your hands. He said one other thing. He didn't fail because he was not brilliant, but he failed because he didn't study. One other thing I took from his speech, he failed, but he was able to bounce back. He said, be modest and be down to earth, being humble. And also set targets and achieve them. Challenge yourself. Thank you very much, Bleoobi, Nashiru, Mahama. I would like to do some few introductions, then we'll take our third speaker. We have in our midst Rebecca Yabua. She happens to be the school prefect 1996, girls prefect. Please welcome her. You know, Accra used to be Miss. Yeah, it was a Miss school. Also in our midst, Emmanuel Kusi Bleoo'96. Thank you for coming. We have Kingsley Kuma Bleoo'97. Pastor Entry has already been here, Bleoo'97. Abbas Siddiq, also Bleoo'97. And the MC, James Akyerekwah, also Bleoo'97. Our next speaker after studying in Accra Academy obtained e-commerce certificate for NIIT. He pursued a foundation degree in IT, networking and security from Bedford College. or University of Bedfordshire. Later, he obtained bachelor's degree in computer networking with honors. He is also a Cisco certified network associate and holds postgraduate certificate in education, all from the Bedford College. He aims at pursuing PhD in VoIP technologies or farm to cell technologies. He is currently a lecturer in computing at Bedford College, UK, married with children. He'll be speaking to us via Skype. Gentlemen, please help me welcome Bleoobi Paul Abrokwa Mensah from the UK. Paul, your audience.
Hello.
I hope you can hear me. I can get a confirmation. I am here to talk about the power of discipline. And I'll talk a little bit about myself before we go into things. So, a brief history about myself. Obviously, I went to Association International School. I was very playful. Didn't take anything really serious, but I knew there was something there, you know. Then from there I went to Accra Academy, a great school. I got mixed up with a whole lot of people, groups. Some were very good experience, some groups for the wrong reasons, but it's all because of what I went through with these other groups, why I am where I am today. I wasn't particularly bright and I wasn't naughty, you know, as such. I was just living, I guess, you know, not taking anything serious. After Crack Academy, I went on to do a private O and A level. I didn't get A stars, but I got, you know, good grades to take me, you know, to the next step. So after that, I went to NIIT. Then, hooray, I found myself. I thought, wow, I really like this IT business. You know, IT is broad. Okay, so when somebody says IT, it could mean a whole lot, but we'll get into that in a little while. Right, so my life in the UK, you know, after a GRC Academy in Accra and all that, I forgot for a very long time, you know, because all I was doing was chasing money. I was doing all sorts. I tell you, you wouldn't want to know. But, you know, thank God, I never took a man's life, but I did everything you can think of, you know. Then I have a mate. He's a very good mate of mine. We grew up together. His name is Dr. Wright. You know, he was about to become an oncologist. You know, an oncologist looks into cancer. Yeah. And he goes to me, what are you doing? You've got the potential. What are you doing? Why are you not concentrating on becoming something? You know, because all this money, don't forget, it wouldn't last. Yes? And I said, what do you mean? He goes, aren't you forgetting about where you coming from a little bit? You know, because you're getting mixed up with all these sort of things. So, you know what? I sat back for a minute and I thought, I think he's right, you know. I know where I'm coming from, so why am I getting involved in all this? But in life, you can't get blind, yes? You can't get mixed up with people, you know. And if you're not strong-willed, then you can't go the other way. Also, a colleague of mine who went to Accra Academy and finished the same year, I think my colleagues remember him, George Nyako. He was doing very well in IT, so we used to speak every day. And he encouraged me all the time, you know, to get my life back into track. So I went back to college. I studied networking and security. But during all my studies, I never ever missed a session. I remember I was doing night shifts, yes, and then going to university during the day. I was very humble, so I would advise all of you to be humble no matter what happens you see in your life, because in actual fact, being humble will take you a lot of money. Also, enjoy the experience of learning. Yeah, because if you don't enjoy it, then what's the point? Yeah. And my last point about my life in the UK is get yourself a mentor, you know, somebody you can look up to. It shouldn't necessarily be a millionaire, okay, or somebody who's got a lot of money, but it should be somebody that you can look up to. It could be your colleague, it could be a member of staff, you know, it could be one of your lecturers or teachers. You know, it could be anybody who can sort of guide you through your educational system and life. So in my case, I had Arthur Wright, I had George Nyakon, my mom and dad. My mom has passed away, bless her. So my dad is still alive. He still pushes me, okay? But the life that I had when I was in Accra Academy, if I should tell anybody now, or whenever I've said to anybody now that I am a lecturer, they go, who? You? You're a lecturer. How? I said, well, time changes. So, you know, everything is possible. You just have to stay on track. Now, the next thing I want us to look into is preparing ourselves for progress. Yeah, there's this thing that my mate, who also happens to be a mentor, he used to always say, every chance translates into an opportunity, but every opportunity is a chance for achievement. Okay, wherever he got that from, I don't know, but when you think about it, and when you really get to understand that, you will know that when an opportunity arises, grab it with both hands. Okay, like some of my colleagues mentioned earlier on, you know, he was a finance analyst and all that. Okay, and now he's a farmer. Maybe he had opportunity. He went for it, and now he's very successful at it. So, you know, it's important to identify opportunities and chances. Okay. Also, surround yourselves around positive, energized people, and also value your time. Okay, because time is everything. Time is everything. Time is money. You know, there's a time for studying, there's a time for playing football, there's a time for playing basketball. I used to like basketball a lot, you know. Time to go to parties and all that. But then you make sure you don't lose track, okay? Whatever you may be studying now, though you might not use it in the future, make sure you do well. You know, you take everything that you are given seriously, yes? Before I tell you a little story, before I got to where I am, as I was studying, like I said earlier, I was doing all sorts. Okay, then I got into employment. I was doing a nice shift and coming to study. My lecturer at the time, I don't know what she saw in me. Okay, she's a very old woman. I wasn't particularly bright, but every, you know, thing that was true of me, I tackled it very seriously, and I took everything serious, not knowing they were watching me. So before I even completed a university, I got a job, yes, with a college in IT. Not a lot of people get such an opportunity, especially coming from Africa and being a black male. I mean, you know, so how you present yourself and how you take things can have an impact, okay? Now, moving on, make sure you stand out. Make sure you stand out for the right reasons, yes? You make sure you stand out for the right reasons. What do I mean by that? You know, at the beginning of Sylvester's talk, I think he introduced seven guys, and everybody wanted to do a white-collar job, which is fine, but in that, you have to make sure that you stand out from the rest, okay? I mean, me, for instance, I might not be bright, but I'm really built, and I take everything that I do seriously. Because of my background in sports as a bodybuilder, I am very disciplined in that respect, okay? So make sure you stand out in whatever you do. Stay focused. Stay focused. I know you guys are young lads, but don't forget, we've all been there before. I never knew I was going to be a lecturer. I didn't. I never knew I was going to be a lecturer. I've been through all sorts, but never knew I was going to land here. How did I land here? By taking everything serious when I got back into education. Yes? So whether you're going to be a doctor or not, you know, whatever you may be doing now, just take it serious, okay? Stay focused, okay? It's not the easiest of things to stay, you know, staying focused, but try. It is achievable, yeah? And most importantly, do not miss opportunities, because some opportunities may come but once. So it's important that you recognize and then you make use of them. Yeah, they always, opportunities always lead to something, okay? They lead to something, yes? Maybe big, maybe small, but it always leads to something, yeah? And it's always good to have a plan, yeah? Plans might not work, yeah, we know that, but having a plan is good, and you should always have a plan B. Now, moving on. In IT, like I mentioned earlier on, everything these days is done through IT, okay? Even farming and all that, okay? You have to know a bit of IT. Now, saying that, Now, I know some of you are studying business and science and the rest, but I would want to advise you to take a look into maybe computer networking. You know, these days you got cloud computing, which is very, very popular. There's also, I mean, the most in-demand skills these days, like I mentioned, is cloud computing. You got statistical analysis and data mining, mobile development, storage systems and management, user interface design, network and information technology, which is, you know, what is my field, middleware and integration software, web architecture and development framework. You got algorithm design, Java development. I mean, there's a lot. So don't limit yourself is what I'm trying to say. Do not limit yourself, okay? Do not limit yourself. Also, believe in yourself. You don't let anybody tell you anything else. Okay, you know what you're capable of, yeah? Impossible is nothing. Everything is possible. I believe in that saying so much, okay? Impossible is nothing. Believe in yourself, yeah? Do not get comfortable. Don't get comfortable wherever you may be or you think you've achieved at the moment. Yeah, don't get comfortable. Always challenge yourself. Push yourself, yeah? Push yourself. Just like going to the gym. I go to the gym, so I apply that to my colleague here is laughing. I apply that to every bit or every aspect of my life, you know, teaching and that. Okay, so it's important. Now, the last thing I want to leave you with is the power of research. The power of research. Look out for stuff. Yeah, look out. Be nosy. Be enthusiastic. Search out, you know, search for new things. Look out for things. Yeah. Analyze the results that you get. Use the results to progress. You know, now I'm speaking to you. A few of my colleagues have spoken to you. I will leave my link. Okay. So if you want to contact me and ask me questions, if you're confused about anything in IT or even in life, I can give you a few advice, okay, because I have been there, done that, still doing it. I've worn the t-shirt, so I'm sure I can give you a few tips on how to succeed. Now, Accra Academy is a very, very good school. Don't let anybody tell you anything else. It is the best thing that have happened to my life. It shaped my life, yeah, because I came across a lot of different people, okay, a lot of different people. And like I said, I was known for Agriasi Academy, but you know, I don't know what happened. I became a lecturer. Unbelievable, but it can be done, yeah. And keep your minds wide open, for the sky is not the limit. It isn't the limit. Beyond the sky is where we want to reach. With that, I think I would say thank you very much. I can't hear myself, so it's a bit difficult. But yes, thank you. I think I'll leave you with that. Thank you very much.
We welcome the people, Abrokwa Mensah from the UK.
I is where we want to reach. With that, I think I would say thank you very much. I can't hear myself, so it's a bit difficult. But yes, thank you. I think I'll leave you with that. Thank you very much.
Welcome,
Thank you very much. Honorable colleagues, it sends me back to the old days, and that sort of changes my speech for now, because I want to go back to the first day that I sat here like you in the assembly hall. That was during our orientation when we were here in 95. And as I say this, I know that my colleagues here are going to have nostalgia about what I'm going to talk about. So we were all seated here, and the prefects who we came to meet in Accra Academy were speaking with us. They came to introduce them. And then I remember the head prefect came to speak with us. And I said in my mind that I was going to be the head prefect of Accra Academy one day. I said it in my mind. Now, I'm starting here because this is where the story started. And I am driving a point from which I know that you are going to really benefit. So here I was here as a greenhorn and a day student thinking of becoming a school prefect in the next 3 years. It was almost impossible because during our time, day students were not allowed to become school prefects. Then the first year, the second year, and the third year, and I was made a prefect of Accra Academy. For us here, and for those of you sitting down there, we know how important the position of a school prefect is. And that is why I am starting from this stage, because it is very important to us. Now, how did we do it? I'm saying, how did we do it? Because my colleagues are here, and there are some who are here who are part of the prefectorial body. It was because of determination. Being a day student and a school prefect was almost impossible during our time, but it happened. Now, I want to tell you something. If your mind can perceive it and your heart can believe it, then it can be done. Don't forget about that. If your mind can perceive it and your heart can believe it, then it can be done. I started this story from this angle because I know that all of you are here with very big dreams and aspirations, like the first speaker actually pointed out by allowing a group of students to say what they want to do if they complete school or their ultimate goal. What this means is that whatever you are here thinking about, you can achieve it. Whatever my colleagues have spoken about, I know that some of you have been dreaming dreams like that. But listen to me, you have to keep awake to make your dream come true. We all believe that you only dream when you sleep, but those dreams never materialize. The only dreams that can come true are dreams that you dream when you are awake. And so whatever dreams you are dreaming now, you are dreaming them because you are awake, and those are the only dreams that can come true. Those other dreams that you sleep and dream will never materialize if you continue to sleep. And so, let me delve a little into what I do, and that is my work as a journalist. That is not what I wanted to do when I was in school. I wanted to be a lawyer. And I'm working towards being a lawyer. But I want to tell you that if things don't move right with the road that you want to take, look for an alternate road, and it will get you there. The reality in life is that you never get what you want always at the spot, but you can get it later on and get it better. So I said I wanted to be a lawyer, but I'm a journalist now. The avenue is not closed. It is just an alternate thoroughfare to the same destination. So as you sit here, a lot of you wanted to be what you didn't get as an offer in Accra Academy here. Maybe some of you wanted to be science students. You didn't get science. Some wanted to be general arts. Are you listening to me? Now listen, you those out there, I was once a school prefect, And my people here will tell you what I could have done if I was still a student. That's just a joke. Let's focus our attention here. Okay. Now, what I'm saying is that you may have wanted to do a certain course. It didn't happen because you didn't get it. But that shouldn't be the end of your dream. The road that you are trudging on now can lead you to what you want to do. So no matter what happens in your life, never give up. No matter the disappointment that come your way, see that as a tool that makes you stronger. Because if you walk without falling, you will never experience the fact of rising from your fall. I know, I want to delve a little into the life of a journalist, and I know that you're going to understand it better because now, apart from mainstream journalism, we have the social media. And once all of you have an experience with a phone before, you have become journalists in a way. Now, coming back to realistic goals, I want to say that what you can do with your phone is massive. So those of you here who have dreams of becoming whatever you want to become, start with your mobile phone. You can explore your mobile phone to the limit, things that you never know you can do. But be very careful what you do with the mobile phone as far as information dissemination is concerned. We in the journalism industry believe in the ethics of journalism. We believe that we have to respect the rights of people. We believe that information that we put out there should be wholesome information. But unfortunately, the other people who do journalism with the social media do not have the kind of training that we have, so they tend to put anything and everything that will interest people in the public domain. Now we have about 22 more days to the elections, and you and I here can make a difference. What you put on a mobile phone and send to people can be something that will make or break. I am saying this because we are trained here as academicians, not only for school, but for what? Thank you very much. I'm happy that you know that. And that is why I am bringing the life experience. So please, before I end my speech, I would want to ask you, to implore you, to do this service once, and maybe more by this time, once, for Accra Academy, by making sure that you become people who practice good journalism. Because whether you like it or not, you make use of the social media, so you are some journalist of some sort. And let us make sure that we contribute to making this election a very peaceful election by sending out what is wholesome. Now, I was looking through my WhatsApp pictures, and I saw an old man who was quartered farming, and part of his underwear was torn. And so you can see part of his nether region. And then somebody was circulating it. And I asked myself if it is my old father in the village who was in such a situation, will I circulate such information about him? So I want you to ask yourself, whatever I send out there, maybe it's an old man sleeping with an open mouth. I'll ask myself, or you ask yourself, if it is your father or uncle who is in that position, will you circulate it? When you do that, it is going to help you to be a good journalist, although you have not attended a journalism school. We have to be good people when we practice this. And when you do that, it can get you very far because people will respect you because you have a good conscience. My life as a journalist has taken me through a lot of circles, and it is not the easy way. Your life in whatever you want to do will take you through other circles, but it is not going to be easy for you. Whatever we have said here right from the first speaker, my friends here, has made it clear to you that it is not easy to achieve what you want to achieve. I wouldn't speak much longer because we'll have more time to speak later. But before I put the microphone down, one more thing that I want to say is that take a clue from my life as a school prefect here, something that was almost impossible was achieved. And then, don't forget that I said that in the beginning I wanted to be a lawyer. I'm not a lawyer yet, I'm a journalist. But it is an alternate path that I have taken that can lead me to my final destination. And finally, be very careful in whatever work you do because you have to respect people. Now you are climbing. The day that you will descend, you meet the same people that you met when you were climbing. And finally, if your mind can perceive it and your heart can believe it, then you can achieve it. Akraka! Akraka! Akraka!
Can we give it one more time for him? Can we hear Espiro one more time? Thank you very much, Jolate Junior. That was a very brief but inspiring speech. Please be, let's be attentive. We'll be taking questions from whatever they said. For those of you that were writing, good for you. Those that were not writing and you were storing everything on the pen drive, hope you will be able to retrieve them and ask the questions. We'll be taking the first batch of questions, 5 questions. They would answer. If you can't remember the name, you can even point out and I'll give the question to the speaker or the facilitator to be able to answer. So the first 5 people that have questions, let me see your hands up. If you raise your hand, 1, please come. You would mention your full name and the course. Please let me have the 5. I would let you. And any other person that has a question, please come. I look like you when I was here. I was like you, but you're a little bit taller than me. Okay. But very slim like him and short like him. Yes. Yeah, third person, any other question? Anybody who has a question? Question time. Question time. Okay, let's take these 3 questions for start. Did somebody raise? Please come. You also have a question? You have a question? Then come, please. So we'll take this first 5 set of questions. You mention your name and your course and the question you want to ask. Like I said, if you don't know their names and can't recollect it so easily, when you point out, I would just let them answer. So please, facilitators, take note of their questions. Thank you very much.
Akraka. 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 I'm Mohammed Abdulkadir, 1/4. Please, my question is, can you be a part-time farmer?
Thank you. He's taking note. He would answer you, okay? You said you are Mohammed. He would answer you.
Good afternoon. I'm Lawrence Adi, 1 Science 1. I want to ask, how many years it took you to finally master the Chinese language?
He would answer you, okay? Thank you very much.
My name is Richard Benfakodia. I'm in 1 Science 2. I wanted to ask, like, the man who helped Mr. Mahama in his life, not his uncle, but the other one who has passed on. Not his uncle, but the other one who has passed on. Who has passed on?
The man who helped him in his life. He was talking about his uncle. That was the same person that helped him in life. I hope I'm right. But he would try and answer. He said he wanted to find out who was really helping you in life. Not his uncle, but the person. It was his uncle, but I think he would answer.
Good afternoon. I'm Evans. Evans Kumi Jr. 1/3. I want to ask them, do they have any problem in choosing their course?
Do they have problem in choosing their
course? Yeah, and what they wanted to be in future. Do you have any problem in that? Yeah, and how they'll have it so easy for them to know what they want to be.
Please, did we get a question? Please wait, please wait. The question is, did they have any problem in choosing their course in secondary school or in the tertiary? Both in secondary and tertiary. What they want to be in future, in the next 5 years or something from now. Okay, thank you.
Atali Mensah William is my name. And I want to ask that. I want to ask the Chinaman that what kept him from learning when he was at this place? What prevented him from learning?
Okay. Thank you very much. Clap your hands for them. I would let Ms. Bleoobi Sylvester take the first question.
Akraka. Now the question is whether you can be a part-time pot farmer. What I expect from all of you is form a society, a group, and go to the headmaster and tell the headmaster, from today onwards, we want to feed ourselves. So we want to form a backyard garden at the back there where we can grow tomatoes, pepper, and if you need any input, let him call me and I'll help. You can be a doctor and be, do you know Frimpong Boati? Who knows Professor Frimpong Boati? He is a part-time farmer. So you can still be a president and be a farmer. All you need is to what? Feed mouths. All right. And the second question, there's a second question. They say, what do we want to be? Okay. The second question was, what do I want to be? And the course that I... do I have any input in choosing my course? Now, seriously, I wanted to be a doctor. When I got to Accra Academy, I changed my course from science to business. I was thinking, oh, science demands a lot of money. And me, I'm broke. I'm a brother. I don't have money to buy even the books that you read. So I decided to move to business. So it took a long time before we were moved. So at the end of it, I find myself in business four. There was business one, two, three, and four. But ever since I changed to business four, that's the course I chose. And I decided to pursue it. So from Accra Academy, I went to Legon, studied the same course that I studied in SSS, then landed in what? In a bank. Have I regretted? No, because today I can do my analysis to tell you what I need to what? To do this farm and what I'll get from what? From the same farm. So I'm a proud academician that studied business, but a proud farmer now. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Bleoobi Sylvester. We'll hear from Bleoobi Nashiru Mahama asking those first questions. Bleoobi Abbas will ask something in relation to what Sylvester just said.
Akraka. Concerning my brother's question on whether you have difficulty in choosing a course. Please, can you hear me?
Yes.
The issue is, at this stage, if you don't want to be oriented with a course that is technically oriented, like being a doctor, that you need science, and want to be in the social sciences, irrespective of what course you are doing now, if you want to become a lawyer, you can become a doctor, and you, when you move on, you can become a lawyer. If you want to do business, it does in Legon or whichever school, it doesn't matter if you are a science student. Once you get the grades, you can move on to do business.
Sylvester, am I lying?
Yes. Yeah, Nashiru was a science student. By now, he is now doing business. You understand me? So please, the courses you are doing, I can move you to another level. All you have to do is concentrate and make sure that you get the required grade that can propel you. Let me tell you, I did business here. I wanted to do business in Legon. I didn't get admission. Some people did science in their various schools. They had admission to do business at Legon. So that is it. You should, whatever course you are doing now, you should take it very serious, and it can lead you to do whatever you want to do in future. Thank you.
Thank you, Bleoobi Abba Sadiq. We'll call upon Bleoobi Nasir to answer his question.
Thank you very much. Ni hao. The Chinese man, one more time. Yes, the question of what prevented me from learning whilst I was here. Actually, I mentioned it in the speech. I said I got myself engulfed with so many extracurricular activities, too many of them. Yes, I was a leader here and there. So many of them. I don't even want to mention them. So many of them that I was so busy, I couldn't get too much time for my books. So if you are one of, or if you are somebody like me who is too much into other extracurricular activities and you have forgotten your books, please wake up, drop some of them, and then go back to your books. It's the main reason why you are here. Okay. So if you want to know why, these are some of the reasons why. And then how many years it took me to learn Chinese language? It depends. Language learning is about interest and how hard working you are towards it. So if I can use 3 years to learn the language and can really speak with you for God knows how long I can do with you. If you're a Chinese man, you cannot speak English, I can communicate with you unlimited. 3 years. And the fourth year, I was like a master, a champion in it, and I could talk anything. You know, so it depends on you. If maybe you can do it 2 years, depending on your high interest, more than what I had. And somebody can do it 4 years or more. So I did mine with 3 years. Okay, that one is answered. And then who else was helping me apart from my late uncle, the former vice president? I have many uncles, but two of my uncles took me up when my daddy passed. The one next to the former vice president is, and my mom happens to be the last born. And so he's the one who took me up right after my dad passed, and then up to the secondary level. Then my uncle Aliu took me up all the way to master's level. Yes, so that one is also answered. The problem with choosing courses, to be honest, I don't know whether I had a problem choosing. My people looked at the grades I made from the JSS, and then they could tell that, hey, this guy is a brilliant guy. He had one in maths, he had one in science and English and all the others, and so he could do science without necessarily consulting me. They just pushed me to science class. Yes, I was good enough to, I was coping, I was doing well. But along the line, I realized that I was not too effective in the sciences. And so when I was going to the university, I looked for business courses. And then lo and behold, I got business administration, marketing option. And then from marketing, master's level, I moved to finance. So it's about your individual interests. And the choice should always, at least they should always consult you. If your parents have chosen some course for you and you think you are not highly interested in that, be humble enough to put it, respectfully put it before them that, hey, please, can you give me the honor of changing this, or do me the honor of changing this course for me? Okay? So course choosing is very important. If they choose the wrong course for you that you are not interested in, you might end up not doing very well in that course. And future ambition, wow. I have an intention of pursuing my PhD in in finance. Or if I don't get finance, but maybe in public administration, perhaps maybe later politics can come in. I have so much passion and interest
in politics, but I'm not doing politics for now. I am concentrating on my life, building my life to a certain level. Maybe I can think of going into politics someday. I don't know as yet. So this is what I can say for now.
We'll hear from SP Ray, his future ambitions. Then we would take some five questions, and that'll be all.
Okay, so somebody asked about future ambitions. Like I said in my speech, I wanted to be a lawyer. I still want to be a lawyer. I'm a journalist and a writer now. In the next 5 years, I should be a lawyer in court. I may stop the journalism work. I may still continue to be a writer, but then I should be a lawyer. So like I was saying, you may not go there straight, but once your ambitions are alive, you get there.
Thank you, Prince Jolati. Sly, Bleoobi, Sylvester has something small to say then. So you have, if you have questions, I'll be taking the next set of questions, five, then that will be all.
Yeah, what I wanted to add was that when it comes to courses, I remember though I did business, when I went to the university, first year, our time, you need to go through some other courses before you are selected into what? The business school. And the courses I read was sociology, philosophy, music, and economics. And I can tell you that accounting that I read, to me, is narrow because it's only accounting. Do you understand? Today, there are so many things that I do in my life that I pick from the sociology that I read, the philosophy. So when you go to the university and you don't get the course that you want to do, please don't be disappointed. Any course that you have, please just take it and read it, and read widely, so that you'll be what? You have a lot of things to do, not just, you know, I want to be accountant, therefore accounting. Do you understand? So you can just be, you broaden your knowledge, and you may be the next farmer in the making. Do you understand? Okay, right.
Thank you. Because of time constraint, we'll be taking two more questions. Then we can have the chairperson's remarks. You know, we have to get some item 13 too. Item 13. So let's take two more questions. You have a question, please come. Okay, you two come. Hey, but you've been here before. It's okay. Let's take only these three questions. Please come. Okay, come. Please come. It's okay. That will be all. So let's have this set of questions and let's answer. Hey!
My name is Enoch Jima. I'm in 1/1. I wanted to ask, at your time, how many halls were you having and can you mention them? How many halls were you having and can you mention them?
Please, my name is Prince Kujo and I'm 1/1. I want to ask the Chinese man that. He said when he was in SHS, Accra Academy, he failed his examination. And I know if you fail the examination in SHS, you can't get access to the university. So did he write an off deck, or because his father was the former vice president, he was able to get access?
The boy has fans, oh. The young boy has a lot of fans, oh.
Good afternoon. My name is Derek TV. My name is Derek TV, and I'm a science student in 1/2. My question goes to Mr. Nashiru Mahama. I wanted to know if you have any strategies or principles I wanted to know if you had any strategies or principles for us that we can use to at least contribute to our nation or society.
If you have any strategy that they can use to be able to help them to be useful to the nation. Thank you.
My name is Frank Tete, One Science One. I want to ask whether when you were in the tertiary and secondary level of education, did you have any challenges? And if yes, how did you overcome them?
Any challenges? Okay, thank you.
I'm at level feeling on One Size Three. Please, I want to ask the Chinese speaking man that he said when you want to learn Chinese language, he can help you without paying any fee at all. So I also heard that he's in charge of the Asogli Power Plant and African World Airlines. So I want to ask that if like somebody wants to go through training to become a pilot, would that person have an opportunity by you to go through that without spending any money?
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much. He wants full scholarship, eh? How many halls? Four. Alema, Ellen, Hamado, and Aulete. There were four halls during when we were in Accra Academy. Okay, please, we'll take the one after the other.
Permission, can I sit here? Okay, I will ask for permission to remain seated whilst I answer the questions. What happened? You failed your exams and then you finally got yourself in a university and now you are a master's holder and even working in a big company and a leader. How did it happen? Yes, when I failed, I mentioned to you that I did not fail because I was stupid. I failed because I was not studying. And so it was a big blow for me. I fell down. So I woke up from my slumber. I dusted myself and I sat up behind my books one more time. I studied really hard and I rewrote my papers and passed again. I passed them very well and I got myself into the university. Okay. And now somebody asks what strategy you need to have to succeed in life. There's no special strategy. The only strategy is hard work. You just have to take your studies seriously because that's what you have been given to do right now. So one thing at a time. The next thing, every other thing you are doing, you must do it and do it very well. You don't just say, let me just play with this one. The next one, I'll be serious. Everything you are doing, you do it with all the seriousness it deserves. And do it and pass very well your exams with flying colors, then move to the next stage, do your hard. That's the only way you can succeed in every endeavor you venture in. And then somebody said, okay, pilot. Yes, our company is an investment company. We invest into projects. So Asogli Power Plant and African World Airlines, they are some of our projects. So yes, we are not dealing directly with those projects, but we have power and control over them. Somebody said if he wants to become a pilot, can he get the opportunity because we are invested into airline? Well, maybe we can help in that to study by way of giving you a scholarship package to study in China. That's probably, but you have to go through some kind of checks, like you have to pass your exams very well, you have to have some reciprocal, kind of things before we can give you that chance. So yes, we can do it, but you have to first pass your exams in the school.
Thank you very much, Bleoobi Nasu. I think right about now, we want to take the closing remarks from our chairman. Then we'll have our closing prayer. Then item 13 would follow. But let me recognize and appreciate our sponsors. Bleoo'97, and Exigency Ghana. Thank you very much for sponsoring this program. And we know next year, God willing, it will be mega. We really appreciate it.
Thank you very much. Akraka. Akraka. Thank you. I will stand in for the headmaster, Mr. Samuel Ufuriaji, and I'm the school counselor, Pastor Kweku Poku Odum. This is a mentorship and a career development program. And I remember 2 years ago when the president, Bleoobi Albert Quartey, came around, and then we started planning. We had the first one last year. It was very successful. And this year, I remember even during the vacation, before you came, the president was around and we're planning. In fact, we wanted this program to be part of the orientation, but we didn't know the time frame where the first years will be reporting. And therefore, we agreed and we decided to fix it on the 16th November, so that by that time, we know that all of you will be around and you have the opportunity to benefit from it. So a lot has gone into it from Bleoo'97, and I want you to put your hands together for them, for the good work that we've done. Thank you. When we are talking of career guidance and development, as well as mentorship, I believe that this is one of the most important topics that a young person like you should pay attention to. And we've had the opportunity for many of them to speak. And you see, they are not just telling you about the various careers and how to get into them, but throughout their life, they've also had certain experiences. And they are sharing these experiences with you so that it will guide you and you can move faster. And that's the essence of mentorship. The mistakes that they committed, they are telling you, and also telling you the shortcut or maybe shorter ways of doing what it took a long time for them to be able to do. And when we listen to that talk, Bleoobi Sylvester Vuvor spoke, Bleoobi Mahama Nashiru, Bleoobi Paul Abrokwa Mensah spoke from the UK, and then we also had Bleoobi Prince Yolati, all sharing their experiences and the opportunities available to them. And they were asking you to stay focused. Stay focused. The way forward is to stay focused. You are now in Form 1. You'll be spending about 2.5 years, less than 3 years in the Accra Academy. And from here, you move on either to the tertiary or other opportunities. And as a result, they are here to tell you what to do right from the start. And I believe that if we have learned a lot from them, then we have to use those experiences or whatever they shared with us to better our lives. And I was happy one of them was bold enough to tell you how he failed. In life, you can fail, but failing is not all. Even after failing, you can still bounce back into success and do whatever you want to do and excel in life. And he was sharing about his success, even traveling all over Africa because of the opportunity he had by studying Chinese. And even before you came, we had opportunity for some of the Chinese universities coming around to talk about the opportunities available to students like you. And I believe that if you have listened to them and you plan your time, you apply yourself to hard work and studies, then this program will not be in vain, but it will yield success in your life. So we thank Bleoo'97. And the mentorship doesn't end here. They are around to talk to a lot of you. And Bleoobi Prince Jolati has been with us for a very long time. Most of the programs he's around to cover it, and we have been working with him. So they are all here. Even after closing, come around, interact with them, and get to know some of the opportunities. And when you came to Form 1, some of you, the problem you had was that your parents chose a course for you and you didn't like the course. Some of you were able to help you out and we made some changes, but it didn't happen for all of you. But as they said, even if you want to do a certain career and the course you are doing is different, if you are successful, you still have the opportunity to change it. They were talking about law, business administration. Monday, I was talking to the final years about the career and university processes and admission. And if you look at a BSc administration, they talk about three core subjects and any three electives, which means that anybody, science student, business student, and art student can get there. So it all depends upon you, where you are right now, and how successful or how you can make use of the opportunities you have that will help you to move ahead in life. On this note, before I end, last year we made a request to Bleoo'97, and this year the letter is ready right at the headmaster's office. So the president, I requested that they help us in the guidance and counseling department. And I was happy. Last year when they came, they made certain donations and they fulfilled their donations. Let's put our hands together for them. If you look at the fans in the assembly hall, at first, when we switch on the fan, it will make so much noise that when we are having programs, we don't switch on the fan and the place is hot. They promised to provide new fans for the assembly hall, as well as the guidance and counseling department. And they provided, is it 20? 20 fans. And these are the fans that has been installed. If you are clapping, do it better. So, we are very much appreciative of the effort and what they are doing for the school. The request I made was concern the guidance and counseling department because it plays a major role in the lives of the student. Currently, the structure in which we are needs renovation, and we also need some materials and equipment to make to help us to give better services to the student as well as expanding our services. So I requested for the renovation of the guidance and counseling department and also for the provision of those equipment. And I channeled it through the president. The letter is ready at the headmaster's office. So I want you to get to know about it because I know and I believe in this group that they'll be able to help us with that. So on this note, I would like to thank Bleoo'97. In fact, I'm very proud of them, and we are very proud of them. The headmaster of the school is very proud of them for the good work that they are doing, for their time that they had in sharing their time with us, and all the piece of advice. I believe that the student will take it up, and that come 2-3 years, most of you will complete successfully and come back as Bleoobi to also share your experience so that the tradition will continue. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Osofudu. Thank you, we appreciate that. The request of the counseling department, oh? Yes, it's very much on our table. I happen to be part of the committee that is taking charge of that, so we would be able to fulfill it. And please, after the program, after the closing prayer, please don't leave. Be seated. Something small for you, but don't rush for it. Don't rush. Sit down quietly. Don't rush. Please be seated. Please be seated. Hey. This last announcement for all Bleoo'97 listening into and watching all over the world. On Saturday, we'll be playing the finals of the Pope Games. And the final, Mr. President, the final is between Accra Academy, Bleoo'97, and Legon Precinct 97. I hope we are going to beat them and lift the cup. So all Bleoo'97 all over the world will be meeting at Lizzie's Sports Complex, Legon, East Legon, for the finals of the Pope Games. We are leading in the goal king chart. We are leading with a lot of goals. We are the top scorer, and I know we are going to be the first. So please, let's be upstanding as I call Bleoobi Abbas Siddiq to give us the closing prayer.
Please sit down. Kindly sit down. Yes, sir. Please, let's keep quiet. Sit down, please. After all that we've heard, there's this one, point I want you all to take note before I say the closing prayer. And it's about our character. If we are very successful in the business, in our business life, and we have very bad character, it can ruin all that we've gained. So you should bear that in mind. Whatever you are doing there, here, whatever you are doing here, academics is not only it. You have to acquire certain knowledges as well. So groom yourself. The headmaster was saying that as we are here, a lot of us came to Accra, Accra. And if you hear the history of some of our friends, you will be marveled. It's very sad. It's very, very sad. And as my junior brothers here, I don't want you guys to go through that. Do you hear what I'm saying? Yes. Yes, you have to groom your character well. It's very, very important. And I will quote from a verse of a poem that a leader wrote to a youth group. And he said that if you conquer the world, you have gained naught. If the wild and terrible self you have not subdued and taught. That is a little advice I'll leave to you guys. Now to the closing prayer. Please keep quiet. There's too much noise here. What we are going to do is that we're going to say a silent prayer. And each and every one of us is going to pray in his or her language or in his or her religion. Whatever. If you are worshiping an idol, you pray to the person. Wherever you are worshiping, just pray. But it should be silent. After the silent prayer, I will end up with a short prayer and say amen to that. So let's all pray in our own language. Rabbana takarbar mina inna ka anta sami udua. Amen.
Thank you, Bleoobi Abbas Siddiq. All too soon, our time is up. And like I told you, be seated. They would usher you and direct you for some item 13. Don't rush for it. Please don't rush. I am James Akyerekwah. I have been your master of ceremony for this program. Thank you, and God richly bless you all.
Thank you. Now, pay attention. Now, listen. We want to do something quickly, and I will come back. We want to take a group picture with the Bleoo'97 year group. And normally we use a staircase so that everybody can be captured. So we want you to move gently to the staircase. And then after, we'll come back and come and sit down for the refreshment. If you are not seated, no refreshment for you. So arrange yourselves and then we'll take the picture.
To everyone who is watching the live stream, we thank you. We're looking forward to next year. Cheers.
before you take your lunch because of the time. So you take the item 13, go to your class, and then after closing, you go and take your lunch. Now, the last three doors, we are using the last three doors. You collect and then you move. Now, when you collect, you don't come back again. Now sit down. The ushers will be moving you, okay, line by line. So get seated. The three of you sit down. Until you are told to move, don't move. Just get seated until they begin to move. So ushers, the ushers will be moving them line by line so that they can